name is Patricia Mary Hund. Patricia Mary Farrell. Daughter of Greg and Martina Farrell of Omega. And I was born at the Ginn Hospital in Omega due to the fact that I had a brother that died a few months before I was born, and he was he was 1 year, 1 month, and 1 day when he died.
Mm-hmm.
What did he die from?
He died from what they call summer complaint. Summer complaint was, it was in August when he died. And he, it's about the same as, you know, it consisted of diarrhea and throwing up. And they put him in the hospital. And that's where he died. He had a private duty nurse. Excuse me.
So you were born in a hospital. How long did you stay in the hospital?
I think that in those days they kept them 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
It was almost unbelievable, and nowadays it's overnight or just a couple of hours.
And so your parents took you home. Where was home?
We lived north of Omega. About a mile north of the city limits, north and a little bit west.
Mm-hmm.
On a farm. Pop and Mom are buying this farm. In those days it was, land was pretty cheap. But they had no money to buy it with anyway, so we had a hard time growing up in the Depression years, and the drought was going on and everything.
What day were you born on?
March 17th on a Holy Thursday.
March.
I don't know if it was Holy Thursday or Ascension Thursday.
I thought you were April.
Huh? April. I said March, I'm sorry.
In what year?
1924.
Mm-hmm. And so you were a child of the Great Depression. You farmed through that here. Did you see the Dust Bowl?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm.
The Dust Bowl. We were at school, I know, and we kept looking out the window, and it kept getting darker and darker. And it was before noon, right around noontime, that the sisters got word to send all the kids home.
Mm-hmm.
So that's because it was getting bad. Anyhow, I walked home with Coke, my brother, and we used to cut through a pasture, you know, to make it shorter. We cut through the pasture, but we weren't for sure which way we were going, because we couldn't see anything, you know. We just had to go by what we used to do, you know. Tried to think about. And we were scared that there was no path, because it was a cow pasture and there were cows in the pasture. But we made it through the pasture and got to the road again and got home. We always walked to school.
How long of a walk was it?
About a mile.
Mm-hmm.
From the school. And the school was right there at the edge of the city limits, close by, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I know, I remember Mom telling my dad, Pop, that his sister, Anella, had scrubbed their back porch 3 times already that day. She was so particular. And they thought it was so unusual. Here she goes scrubbing the porch 3 times already. And they didn't know why she just didn't leave it alone and wait till the dust settled.
How much landed that day, or how much came down? Was it feet Was it a whole bunch? What was it?
What?
The dust.
The dust?
Yeah. Was it, you had this dust storm.
The dust was real thick in the air.
Mm-hmm.
Real thick. And it was kind of red, and one of the boys asked Pop why it was so red, and he said it because some of it was coming from Oklahoma, and they had red dirt down there. But most of it was from western Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I don't suppose the dust would collect more than an inch, unless it was blue like snow does, you know, and drift. That was really a scary time. It lasted about 3 days. That's when we were out of school, 3 days.
Didn't you have a childhood illness? A serious one?
Oh, growing up, oh yes. When I was a baby, I weighed 10 pounds when I was born, so they say. I was very sickly, and by the time I was 9 months old, I got my birth weight back, and I started getting better. Anyway, they decided that that was polio that I had at the time, and it left my one leg crooked, turned my foot was turned in, and I couldn't walk very good. So I had to go to Kansas City. My dad had to go to Kansas City to get, because he went blind, and I went with him, and there's a doctor down there they had taken me to, and that doctor decided that in my infancy that I had polio. So he put my leg in a cast, and Annanella was working down there at the time in Kansas City, and she helped my dad around because he was going blind, and when they put my cast on, we went down on the train. The train would go through Omega, and we'd have to get up early, and it was always dark when we got on the train, it seemed like. So Pop and I got on the train and rode to Kansas City, and then his cousin, whom we called Aunt Grace, and she and her husband would meet us and take my dad to the hospital and take me to their place. But first I had to get that cast on my leg. And I remember them taking my shoe and stocking off of my leg. I don't know which one it was now, but as we were leaving the doctor's office, I started crying, and Pop says, "What's the matter now?" And I says, "Does it hurt?" And I says, "No, but somebody's got my shoe and stocking." And I couldn't find my shoe and stocking. Well, Annanella put it in her purse, and I didn't know it. So they got me settled down because she showed me that she had my shoe and stocking there.
How old were you at the time? Do you remember?
I was about four and a half by the time they decided what was wrong with me.
So Grandpa's eyesight, how did he lose it?
Well,
how old were you?
That's how old I was. About the same time I got my leg fixed. Four and a half, I'd say. And my dad's eyes, well, the one eye was real bad, and the doctor said it's a cataract, and it had to be removed. Well, at that time, what is now KU Med Center, it was the Bell Memorial Hospital. And so my dad was at the Bell Memorial Hospital because that's where the doctor worked. But anyhow, the doctor, when they were ready for him and called him down there, to remove the cataract, which they did, and they did. They discovered that the doctor had nicked his eye and he lost all the fluid out of his eye. And he's blind in that eye. And a few years later, his other eye was real, real bad. And it had a cataract on too. However, but they said that it went, his good eye went blind because of sympathetic, what they call sympathetic blindness. And since we all have so much trouble with our eyes, just my sisters and I, we had different doctors, and I asked my doctor about sympathetic blindness. He said, yes, there's such a thing as sympathetic blindness, because he said, but it's usually due to some trauma, an accident or something. And my sister Mickey said her doctor told her when her retinas tore that he didn't know if this would be hereditary from my dad or not, because he said it's usually hereditary through the sons. The boys are the ones that have the eye trouble. And I had five brothers, and not one of them had any eye trouble. And there were five of us girls, and all of us had torn retinas. So that's why when my son started having torn retinas, Bill's the worst. He had several tears and had to be taken to the hospital for repair work. Bernard has torn retinas. And then Ralph had a couple torn retinas. My three oldest boys. So I wrote to all the boys and told them they better get their eyes checked right away, because even if they're in good shape now, if they do have trouble later on, they'd have something to compare it to with their earlier records. So they're all happy to get it done, and the rest of them so far are real good. The reports were good. But that's 3 out of 9. Mm-hmm. The girls haven't had any eye trouble, which I'm thankful. I'm thankful that the boys caught it in time.
Now, you say you were, the depression was a tough time, but you survived it, right? Your whole family survived it.
Yeah, we did.
And you kept the farm?
It was hard. Yeah, it was hard. My dad going blind. And he kept up the fences, go out in the pasture. He'd always repair the fences with the wires, digging post holes, replacing the post. And I was usually the one that went with him. We had horses. We didn't have tractors and cars and things at that time. So I'd have to sit in the wagon with him, and he'd drive the horses. And as we'd go down the road, he'd say, well, he said, is anybody coming? Other people did have cars, old Model A's, Model T's, and if I'd just hear a car coming or see one, I'd say, Pop, you're too close to the ditch, or you're too close to the middle of the road. That car can't get by. And so I worked as his eyes to get to the pasture by the way of the road. And I remember different times riding in the wagon with him, with the horses. And that's how we managed to get some of the work done. Dennis got old enough, he worked the land. And Coke did too. Well, Jean had to go out because we had four horses. There was two sets of horses. And she could do some cultivating and raking hay and things like that. That wasn't quite as bad as plowing and disking. Those were harder jobs. I think harrowing was kind of tricky, so she didn't do the harrowing. So, and while they did that, it was our job when we were, I was quite a bit younger. I'd have to go take them water or middle of the hot afternoon, take some a lunch up or something to them. And so that was what we did in our summer, the summertime. However, we had a few sheep, around 20, 24, and there's no feed for them, so we'd have to take those sheep out. It was usually Coke and Matt and I, or Coke and Ben, probably. Matt was the youngest. But we'd take those sheep out to the down the road and find some weeds and green grass or something along the post line, the fence line, and we'd sit and watch. They'd find that some green grass, and then they'd all stop and all want to eat right now. And so we'd sit down and watch them and wait and try to find shade or something to sit until the sheep got tired grazing where they were, or till they ate it all, and then they'd want to head on further to look for more. And of course, when we couldn't go very far from home, so we had to make the sheep go back to the house. Other times we went down to the pasture, and near the fields they'd find some grass in the fence rows between the pasture and fields, and the corn and wheat. And so while they were eating in those spots, we'd find little mud holes, ponds. You know, we had a couple ponds, but they were drying up. But we'd find mud holes, and they'd still have water in. And tadpoles. We liked to watch the tadpoles. We'd get an old can or something and get the tadpoles and take them home and put them in the tank so they wouldn't die, you know. Of course, we liked it when the tadpoles, we put boards in the tank too, and when they'd start turning into a frog, it was real interesting watching them swim in the water and then jump up on the boards as they got to be little tiny frogs. Yeah. As they did that, that one day, the ducks, Mom had some ducks, not very many, just a few, and Grandma had given them to her. And the ducks got in the tank and they ate the tadpoles and the frogs, the baby frogs. Oh, that made the boys mad. So Cook went and grabbed a rock and threw it at him and hit one duck in the head and knocked him down. And we thought, sure, we had a dead duck on hand. And we decided we'd take it north of the barn and bury it so Mom wouldn't see it. So we took it north of the barn, and it's getting late in the afternoon. And it took us a long time to try to dig that hole. The ground was just real hard, like cement. We'd take turns digging and digging, and we stopped once or twice or maybe more and look how deep it was, and then look at the duck, and it wasn't deep enough. So we got dug for quite a while, and when we decided to quit and put the duck in anyway, we turned to find the duck and it's gone. So we looked and looked, and finally here Mom was out throwing feed out on the ground for the chickens and the ducks, you know. And we saw it over there eating with the other chickens and ducks, and come to find out, I guess Coke just stunned the duck and it's unconscious. And so we didn't have to worry anymore about Mom getting upset.
Did Mom find out about the rock?
Did she know about it?
Did she ever find out?
I think she did. She always found out, mm-hmm. one way or another, what we were up to.
Mothers do that.
Yeah.
What other animals do you have that were interesting? I remember you once telling me a story about the turkeys.
Oh, yeah. The turkeys. We had sometimes around 10, 12 turkey hens. Well, the folks had to make a living somehow, so we'd raise the turkeys and sell them at Thanksgiving and Christmas. So what we'd do is turn the turkeys loose, the hens, and some would lay their eggs right around the yard there. But when a couple of them went clear across the road and down the fence line to the pasture and down there, that was quite a ways, you know. And we wouldn't know they did that until Mom would check the nest. And every time they'd lay an egg, we'd take the egg to the house very carefully so we wouldn't hurt it, crack it or anything. And Mom would give us a chicken egg to put in the nest. Well, the chicken, see, if there wasn't an egg in their nest, they wouldn't go back and lay another egg. So it's our job to watch those turkey hens, mm-hmm. and make sure there was a couple she knew that they were going someplace to lay an egg, and we didn't know where. So we had to watch the turkeys. And sometimes it'd take an hour, and it seemed like forever for us, because we were tired in this hot weather, you know, in the summertime. So if we couldn't find them, which we tried very hard, why, she did borrow a couple little bells from her mother, tie around the turkey neck, and so that the turkeys knew we were watching them. That's how they could sneak away. But when we put the bells on them, we could hear them, because when they start running off to find their nest, the bell would ring louder and longer. So we could find the turkeys that way. And so then after she got, as soon as she'd get 10 eggs, turkey eggs, they were bigger than a chicken egg, and they were kind of speckled. As soon as she found those eggs, she would get some setting hens and have the setting hens hatch those eggs. And so we had chickens the setting hens were much gentler than the turkeys, and they wouldn't break the eggs when they were setting on them like the turkeys would. The turkeys were bigger and their feet were bigger, and oftentimes they would break an egg accidentally. So here we'd have a bunch of hens running around with all these little turkeys following her. And they were pretty neat looking. We liked it. And my dad would, and we'd make it, he would get these old cars that had hoods on, you know, and they would be wrecked, and they'd bring them out and put them in ditches, you know. Well, he took these covers and framed them with wood and put a wire netting in the front for doors. And that's where she'd get the hens and baby chicks and put in there. Pop would make a door for them, you know. What we had to do is get what he wanted, you know, find it around the ditches or something is made out of wrecked cars, you know, except for the wire. Sometimes you'd have to buy the wire and the fastener for the door, for the front. And we had about 15 of them he made, which at night we had to close them in because we were afraid the coyotes would get them. And we'd let them out in the daytime. Well, the only thing in the daytime, we'd have to check on them every now and then because the snakes would come and they would eat the baby turkeys. And we found a lot of them that did that. And we'd have to holler for Mom to come to kill a snake.
You didn't kill them?
Huh?
You didn't kill the snakes?
Well, we were little kids.
She always made me kill snakes.
Huh?
She made me kill snakes.
Well, you're not a little kid.
I was.
What? Third, fourth grade?
Yeah.
Well,
younger.
We were afraid. We didn't know which ones might be poisonous. But we always had Mom to come, or maybe Dennis if he wasn't in the field. We had to learn to, as we got older, to kill them, but we didn't then. And then at Christmas and Thanksgiving, we'd sell turkeys. We had about 80 a year. And that was another job for my dad, even though he is blind. He had a hatchet or an axe, probably both, depending on which one we could find. And we'd get a block of wood, put two nails in, like this, you know. And then he'd get a turkey. Mom would give him a turkey she wanted to dress, you know. And he'd take the wings, pull the wings down, the tips of the wings to the feet, and put that head between those two nails and chop its head off, you know. Well, those turkeys were strong, a lot stronger than chickens, you know. And then he tried to hold it and let them bleed out there, you know. That's how we'd kill the turkeys to dress. And I had these people in Kansas City that were related to us. She would every year say, "Now don't forget, Martina, I want two turkeys." She says, "One for Thanksgiving, one for Christmas. Now you get them dressed, and when you put them on the train, get them dressed and put them on the train. Let me know, call me, and we'll go down and meet it." So that's how and she gave us $5, and we thought that was real good money. Mother did in those days, because we didn't have any cash at all. So that's how, every year for several years, that's what we did, put the turkey on the train and call her right away. Tell her to meet the train. We got $5 for Thanksgiving, $5 for Christmas, my folks did, to spend. But of course, there at Omega, they did dress turkeys for different ones that wanted them. But they didn't get that much money.
What else did you sell?
Oh, a few years there, Mom made a hotbed. And she made this hotbed and put in cabbage and all kinds of vegetable plants, seed, onions, everything. And then put an ad in the paper and say, "Garden plants for sale." We get a nickel or a dime for a dozen. Or not we, but my folks would. And then as they produced, we also planted some in our garden and had to raise them there. And we'd shell peas and sell them to the town people. And then later on, we went into dairy business. We had to milk cows. And then I never did milk. I tried a time or two, but I didn't get very far.
Here, we can,
he never liked to talk about the war.
Mm-hmm. Now, how old were you when World War One started? World War II started for America? Back
home. World War II, when they started drafting him?
Well, Pearl Harbor. How old were you on Pearl
Harbor?
When it was attacked?
I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was a junior in high school. So I'd have been, what, 16, 17 in there?
Mm-hmm. And do you remember that day?
Yeah. I just remember coming in the house, and my dad was listening to the radio, and it sounded like something terrible happened. I mean, the way he acted, you know. He hollered at Mom, he said Pearl Harbor was attacked by the Japanese, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I didn't know much about it at the time. But I do remember how everybody was very riled up and everything. And then they started I think they just started drafting about then, didn't they?
I don't know.
I don't know if they drafted the boys before Pearl Harbor or not.
Did any of your brothers go off to fight?
Well, Dennis didn't go. He had to stay and farm for my dad. But I know I went to school at Leavenworth to become a nurse as soon as I got out. I went to Wichita and worked a year. And then I went to Leavenworth to go to school to be a nurse.
Mm-hmm.
And the war was going on then. And I know Maureen left when Coke left. He went to the Navy. He is being drafted. And Tom and Matt was at Benedictine, going to school at Moore Hill. And then Tom went off to war. I don't think Matt did, because Matt had to stay home and farm. He was the youngest. Dennis had gotten married and he had moved away. What's that noise?
Maybe he's done now.
I think so. There was 10 years in difference between your parents' ages. How old were they when they married?
My mother was 21. Pop was 30, I think.
Uh-huh. And so how did you meet Ivo?
Well, I was quite a bit younger than Dennis. And we went to Flush dances. I didn't get to go till I was a senior in high school. But he and Jean Marianne went to Flush dances. Dennis went with her for 2 years. Marianne went with Ivo's brother.
You left that part out in this.
What?
We didn't get it recorded. That
yeah.
Uncle Dennis dated who?
Ann.
We didn't get that recorded on there. Pause it for a second.
I didn't hit the button quick enough.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
And Marianne dated Ivo's brother for a couple of years.
Which
was Jerry. Gervais, and then he had heart trouble, and they broke up after a couple of years. And I met, of course, they'd come and go, and carload at a time, you know. They'd come down from Flush, and Ivo was going with a neighbor girl, Ethel Hooper. He went to service, and of course I knew him before he went, because when he'd get, they'd come down in the same car, and then if he wasn't on speaking terms with Ethel, he'd stay at our place, and Marianne and Jerry would drive around someplace, and Dennis and Ann would go someplace, and Iva would stay at our house because I had to take care of Mickey and Elaine. And Pop and Mom always had to go someplace on a Sunday, you know. It was only on Sundays, it seemed like, that they came down like that. So that's how I met Iva. It was just being, he'd come down with his brothers. And then he went off to war. And I wrote to him as a pen pal, because he was in service. He was in India, Burma, China theater through the war. And he went overseas, of course, and he's in right at 5 years in the war. And when while he was gone, why, Ethel wrote him a Dear John letter, what they called. Dear John, you know what those were.
Yes.
And she got married to some guy and came back and he said he saw the Golden Gates December the 15th coming home from
in San Francisco?
Yeah. And then they had to wait a week or two in San Francisco to get papers straightened out and all before he could be discharged. And he got home just a day or two before Christmas. And he came down to see me. I was still in nurse's training. But he is shell-shocked. He was...
He was shell-shocked?
Well, that's kind of what the term they used when they...
I didn't know he saw combat?
Oh, yes. A lot.
Really? I thought he was a mechanic.
He was with airplanes, but he had to taxi the airplanes, and the enemy would fly over and drop bombs. And I know his buddy from... where was he from in South Dakota. They were very close buddies. He was killed. Ivo had fixed his plane or something, and they were taxiing him over to another place, and they had to taxi him over without lights and all during the night because the enemy was overhead dropping bombs. And that's how his buddy was killed. That's who Bill was named after. I will say that. They said if they ever got married, either one, they'd name their first son after, like I did. He said, William Eugene, that was his name. William Eugene Hall. He lived up there around the Black Hills.
Mm-hmm.
We went to see him on our honeymoon. His parents, that is.
Mm-hmm.
No, when he got home, he had a pretty rough time at home, too.
Mm-hmm. How so?
Well, they kept teasing him and making loud noises, surprising him, shocking him. He had a younger brother that's pretty ornery. That way, and I know he was so nervous anyway, and then if he'd go upstairs to his room or something, why he'd be hiding behind the door or something and jump out and scare him,
His brother, younger brother never went off to war or anything?
Huh?
His younger brother missed out on the war entirely?
His brother.
Which brother, Pete? He didn't go to war.
No, he didn't. But it took him about a year or so to kind of settle down. That's why he left and went to Short and Anna Marie's. Because they didn't have children or anything. He worked for Short there for a while, about a year.
Mm-hmm. And then when did you two start dating?
Come down to see me on just as soon as he got home, within a week, and then I got a couple of days off and came home to my folks, you know. It's just at Christmas time that I had to go back to the hospital to work, study. And we start dating right away. First it's every week or two, then it's about every week he'd come down on a Saturday or Sunday, whenever I could get time off.
How long would it take to travel from to Wichita? From Omega.
He lived to Short Anne Marie and I was in Topeka.
Oh, you were in Topeka at the time? How long did it take to drive that far?
From Flush to Topeka?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. He had to borrow his dad's car or Charlie's or somebody's. I suppose it, well, what does it take now?
Well, now you can drive 75 miles an hour. I didn't know how fast they could drive back then.
I think it's 60, 65.
Really?
What kind of a guy was Ivo? How'd you describe him?
He liked to tell jokes. He liked to play with kids. He was kind, he was generous, he was interesting. He'd come down, we'd go to a dance what's the name of that place? They had two big dance halls. The name bands would come to. Not Golden Acres, but something like that. I know Tommy. I used to know the names of those big bands.
Tommy Dorsey, or?
Yeah, Tommy Dorsey. And
Glenn Miller?
Yes. Another one. But we like to go out there when the big bands come to Topeka. They'd come New Year's Eve, different weekends. He was particular, especially with his shoes.
Really?
They had to really shine, be spotless.
All shoes or just dress shoes?
All shoes.
And how'd that go from working on a farm?
Well, if they weren't, if as far as work shoes went, he would leave them outdoors, you know. But he'd bring them in if they were cleaned up good, but just for every day, I mean, if he wasn't on the farm. But I know he'd just shine and shine those shoes. He'd even shine shorts shoes for him. He'd look like a mirror. That's something they weren't used to.
Mm-hmm. You said he liked jokes. Do you remember any of his jokes? Did he like certain ones?
Like practical jokes on people.
Yeah, to tease.
Uh-huh.
He liked to tease a lot.
You ever play good pranks?
Oh, I'm sure he did, but they all did up that way. Around the flesh, you know. I can't think of any right now. If I think about it a while, I would. No, they'd get in the parades, the car, you know, at his work up there. They'd fix the car up to get in the parade, the 4-H or
the
county.
July?
Huh?
Fourth of July parades and stuff?
Yeah, they'd have a big parade. And I know this one time they fixed the car up, it would stop and go and stop and go, and then they did something to it so that it looked like it's jumping. You know, the back end would jump up and down, and it caused a lot of the crowd to laugh a lot.
And how long were you, like, going out, and then when did you propose?
It's a year and a half later,
mm-hmm.
after he got back from service.
And how long back then did you, how long did you wait until the wedding?
Let me see. We were married in April of 47. I guess a year and a half. A year later, he probably proposed and gave me time to get out of training. And I worked at Nebraska for 6 months and went on to St. Joe for a couple months. Did private duty. And I was only up there a couple months and came home to get married. So it was about 6 months later afterwards.
Mm-hmm. What kind of a wedding was it?
Married in the morning?
Huh?
What time of day did you get married?
We got married at 8:30 in the morning.
And then
went over to Father's house for breakfast. And then went out to the farm for a chicken dinner. And that's, you know, all my brothers and sisters and Father's priest, couple priests were there. Father Beeler and Father Kugelmeyer and Father Coleman. Then there's a priest from St. Mary's that he was a Jesuit. They had a Jesuit college down there at that time. And he used to come to Topeka a lot, and he and with Dave, and we'd spend the evenings together. He was at our wedding. Father Kenny. He's a real young, just got his ordained, you know.
And then you had 12 children, right?
I did, yes.
Was that, like, or about how many kids people had back then? Or, because when I tell people today that my grandma had 12 children, they can't believe the gasp. It amazes them.
Well, in those days, they thought, well, I'm sure, a lot of them, that they were beginning to say, you know, you shouldn't have that many children at all. Well, how can you become a Catholic and live your religion and believe in it and not have a bigger family? You don't know what might happen. I know I've always said you'd like to have 4 or 5 children. I thought whatever God sent was whatever God sent, you know.
How many were in Dad's family? He was the...
There were 11. 3 girls and 8 boys.
And 10 in yours. 5 and 5. So he beat him by one?
But it was about that time that people started cutting down their families and doing what they wanted. It wasn't much fun to go out with people, and then they would say, my goodness, you have so many children. Why don't you do something about it? Why don't you go to the drugstore? Right there, people in your church, they all go to the drugstore. They use preventatives. I said, well, if you have to use preventatives, that's pretty bad.
So what was it like raising 12 kids?
Not as bad as it sounds. I had 3 daughters and 9 boys. The boys always kind of looked after each other. It was nice, you know. And they kind of looked after their sisters too, whether they knew it or not. So I was thankful for that, you know. And they had to, they did a lot of the, when it come to cooking, they were in the kitchen a lot, and I didn't realize that they were really watching how I was doing the cooking, because so many of them today cook a lot. They say, well, I watched you. I watched you when we were at Onega. Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know how they learned it, but they did. Even though there were accidents, like Kevin pulling the skillet over on him, electric skillet, and frying chicken. I was at work. You know,
we had many a fire inside of the oven. Mom didn't know about.
What?
We had fires inside of the oven many a time. We knew what baking soda was for. We knew how to put them out. I even had a fire on top of the stove on the farm one time. Spilled grease on the burner.
Yeah.
Started the fire.
I did that out here at the farm.
I did it too.
When I married Ivo, we moved to the Flush, to the farm there, and what was I going to tell you?
You still worked as a nurse?
Ivo didn't want me to work, so I stayed home until finally I did talk him into letting me work after we were there about 5 years. He let me do private duty. He said at night, if you want to go ahead and work just 2 nights a week, no more. If I, you know, because he was afraid I wouldn't get the rest I should, because we had 5 children at Flush. And it's quite a job, you know, to take care of the kids and to get your sleep and work all night. But his mother had a stroke, and I had to, she was real bad at the hospital, you know, so I got a hired girl in, and I took care of his mom at the hospital, private duty, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Then I did work at Westmoreland private duty a little bit. I taught mom how to give shots and things so she could be a nurse aide. At that time, nurse aides could give shots if they learned how. But nowadays, only RNs can. I think LPNs can too now.
You moved from Onega what year?
After, Maureen died that year. 55, Jerry was born. Weren't you at Onega?
Weren't you in a car accident or something? Flush?
Yeah, one slick morning.
You were heading to?
I was heading to church. It was a holy day. And I was headed to church that morning. And I turned the corner there, and there was, it had ice all over the road, which I didn't realize, and then it snowed, you know. And I just turned the corner a little ways, and the car hit a rut. They weren't paved, the streets weren't. Hit a rut and turned the car sideways and over on the side. But I wasn't hurt.
Who was with you?
Nobody.
You were by yourself. And you're pregnant?
Yes, with Ralph. But, see, I would go to church and come home, and then Abby would go to church. We didn't take the little kids to church. We took turns going to church. Of course, we had two masses in, too.
Why did you take little kids to church? Were they just too much trouble, or?
We thought they were distracting people. We didn't want to distract people in church. We took them once in a while, but not as a rule. At Onega, one of us would go to Wheaton to church, one of us would go to Onega to church, because they only had one mass at each place. Oh, we took them after they started to school,
mm-hmm.
but just the babies, we didn't.
Was it the usual thing back then to not bring small children to church?
Very few took the babies to church. As a rule, because you don't get anything out of Mass if you're there taking care of the baby. You miss what's going on.
Do you remember Vatican II?
Yes, I remember it.
I've never seen a Mass where the preacher or the priest faces away from the congregation. What's that like?
The Latin Mass?
Yeah.
Well, he had his back to the people. And they didn't have this little altar out in front. He said he was facing the tabernacle and would go from one side of the tabernacle to the other with the prayers. Everything was in Latin. And then at Holy Communion, they had a cloth that they'd put over the railing. It was tacked on one side. When it was time for communion, the servers would go down and pull this cloth over the railings. And then the father would give out Holy Communion. Of course, the server would be there with a paten under your chin. I don't know how to tell you what it was like, because it wasn't as meaningful. You didn't get as much out of it.
You don't miss it?
Miss it.
Do you miss the...
I did miss it a lot, but I learned so much more with the English, because I understood English. I didn't understand the Latin.
Was the homily given in Latin, or?
No. But at Flush, it was a German town,
mm-hmm.
and the priest there would always give it in German, the homily. And that's why the Farrells finally moved from Flush. They were only there a couple years, and they moved because the homily was always in German. And they were Irish, and they didn't understand it. So they moved on to Omega.
Mm-hmm.
But how would you like, if you didn't know any Latin or anything, can't you understand what Mass would be like if it was in Latin and you just guess at what's going on?
They still have them now. They're called Tridentine Masses. They still do them from time to time here, actually in Fargo.
They have Latin.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they have it here at St. Mary, or wherever Duggan and that go. Silver Lake, Maple Hill. They have Latin there too. And they like it. I think they're missing out on a lot.
So you have 12 children. How many grandchildren do you have?
68, about 17 great-grandchildren.
Wow.
That's including step.
Huh?
That's including step grandchildren, right?
Quite a bit then.
Hmm?
Quite a bit then, huh?
Quite a bit, what?
Of grandchildren, great grandchildren.
Well, yeah, not so many though, if you think I have 23 kids. See, Ellen and Lauren and weren't married. Kevin is no longer married.
I don't know, I have one child.
I was thinking there were three of Dave's that weren't married. Janet's married now.
Patrick?
Al Patrick, yes.
I'm about out. Anything you think I should have asked you about?
I don't know. After 84 years, you don't remember things.
Well, you were a junior in high school on Pearl Harbor, and I was a junior in high school on 9/11.
Oh.
And so that was kind of interesting. And one of the things I wondered is, because it put our country into a new war, and change our attitudes about a lot of things. Do you see a connection between our two generations in that?
Well, yeah, of course, people are all frightened and scared and not knowing what's coming next. To think such terrible things are happening.
Out of all 84 years, what are some favorite moments? Do you remember anything special? Outside of your children being born or somebody's wedding. Is there anything special that stands out? Or is there just too many to name one?
Well, I think now, I mean, in those days, we used to have dances, and I think we had a happy moments, you know, that happy things happening. And we really enjoyed that. And where's the dances today? Where's the children aren't learning, you know, to get along with each other and to be able to do the, have the happy dancing going on and music and...
Good clean fun.
Yeah. And I think that's why there's so much obese today, because of the, you lose a lot dancing, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Dancing and sledding. And there used to be more farms, you know, farms where people really had to work hard, and they, I think that's, they didn't. Of course, during the Depression and all, you never had food. We had to eat dock weeds, go out and find weeds to eat instead of for a vegetable, you know. And wild strawberries and elderberries and a lot of wild things we had to go search for ourselves. We didn't have the candy and all of that that they have nowadays.
Back when you were in the Depression, you never really got to eat a lot of meat, foods. You were, had a pretty limited diet, didn't you?
Well, we were trying to buy the farm, the folks were, and the reason we didn't, we had to when we sold chickens, sold eggs, sold any pigs, any kind of meat, we had to turn all of that money over to get it, the farm paid for it. Now, there was gambling at the crossroads about a fourth of a mile from us. If we see car lights down there at night, you know, the next morning we'd get up early and go down real quick, and we'd find maybe a dime. Once Jean found a quarter, and that was a lot of money. Then we'd turn it over to Mom. She'd go to town and buy a soup bone. And that's, you know how much meat's on a soup bone, usually none. But she'd get a soup bone for 10 cents. We'd like that. And I know going, this Mike Moriarty had a pasture right north of us, about a half mile. And he had an old Model T, or not, some kind of, it didn't have a top on it. And we'd hear him coming from about a half mile away. And we'd all, of course, chickens were running loose in the yard, you know. They were out there by along the road. There's two big lilac bushes, you know, and how chickens root around the bushes and dig in the ground, you know. They'd be sitting there and finding a, especially in the winter, a cool in the summertime. And they'd be rooting around out there. And when we'd hear the car coming, why, we'd sneak out there real quiet like, my brothers and I. And then we'd see the car just about there. We'd shoo the chickens out on the road. And that way, see, he usually hit one, you know, not taking them by surprise, you know. The chickens were going all directions out there. So we'd run out and grab that chicken and run and tell Mom that car hit a chicken. Here's a chicken the car hit. Well, she'd get the tea kettle on right quick and get the water boiling so we could scald the chicken and clean it, you know. Get the feathers all off and everything and get the chicken dressed. And then we'd have chicken and dumplings. See, she couldn't sell that chicken. And if same way, well.
So you would purposely kill one of your mom's chickens so she cook it for you? Did she ever catch on?
I don't know. She might have. But we did that a few times because we were so hungry. We wanted... We love chicken and dumplings. We love any kind of meat. What else could we do? We were just little kids, you know.
How old were you when you did this?
Oh, it'd be in the summertime, I suppose. Between 5 and 10 years old. My brothers, you know, Coke was a year, 15 months younger than me. Ben was year younger than Coke, and Matt was a couple years younger. So, you know, we could think of things like that. We had to, we're out there with the animals anyway. But of course, we couldn't do that to the pigs or the cows or anything. And if we'd have thought of something, we probably could, but they were too big for us to.
Taking a little too much virtue on those.
Well, another time, Dennis is one that the dogs from town would come out to they'd kill sheep, you know. If you get two or three dogs together, boy, they'll go out and kill anything. And that one night, we heard some commotion out in the sheep pen right south of the house. And my dad, Pop, said to Dennis, he says, "Dennis, get the gun and shoot up in the air. Scare those dogs away." So he got the gun and ran out on the porch and he shot, you know. And then we heard a lamb go baa. So we grabbed the flashlight and lantern and went out and there he shot a lamb. And so we were out there holding flashlights and a lantern for Dennis to butcher that lamb, because We weren't going to let anything go to waste. Well, we didn't. That was an accident. But Papa said, I remember Papa saying, Dennis, I told you to shoot up in the air. You didn't shoot up in the air, or you wouldn't have hit that lamp. And Dennis says, Pop, I shot up in the air. I remember that. But anyway, we wouldn't eat a lamb if we had to. But we had to. To this day, I don't want to eat a lamb, even if I was starving.
Why?
Because they were so nice.
I thought you didn't like the meat or something.
No. Well, I didn't like the smell of it. But, you know, it just turns you against it. Then Grandpa Straub had 300-400 head of sheep and lambs. And when his ewes, sometimes he'd lose a sheep having a lamb. Well, one ewe did die, and it had twins. Well, here comes Grandpa Straub with his two little lambs, baby lambs. And he says he didn't have time to take care of them. He didn't know what to do with them. So Coke and I got a lamb to raise.
And one each?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Coke got named his Prince, so I named mine Princess. Two little lambs, you know. And we did get some milk and heat it up a little bit in the house, you know, and put it in a pan and come out because we didn't have a bottle and nipple for them. So the lambs, they would kneel on their front knees, front legs, you know, kneel down to drink their milk so they could reach the milk. And we'd tell Pop, look. We'd say, Pop, look. Well, Pop would look, but he couldn't see, you know. This lamb kneels down to eat. He thought that was so nice that we taught him to kneel down and eat.
Did your father ever hunt for food or like try to get a deer or?
Oh, in the wintertime, they hunted for whatever they could find, squirrels and rabbits and anything they could find. We didn't eat coyotes or anything like that. I don't know why, but we didn't. I know during the war they said they ate dogs over in Germany and other places.
Hmm. And now we have so much. Is it ever hard to take in how easy it is to get food today?
What about it?
Does it ever amaze you how easy it is to get food today compared to back then?
Oh, yes, yes. Nowadays, I think kids they can get money easy and get what they want, you know. The only thing we looked forward to was that once every summer, the drugstore would put an ad in the paper. One ice cream cone for an egg. So we got to take one egg, each one of us gets to town, and give it to the guy at the drugstore, and he'd give us an ice cream cone.
Did you get scared while you were carrying to the drugstore that you might drop it?
Of course we were. But we were careful because we wanted that ice cream cone. We could have chocolate, vanilla, strawberry. I think they even had lemon.
Thank you.
don't you think, do you think there's very many kids that could, exist today if they had to, if money was taken away? Would they know how to get along?
I worry about that sometimes.
You do?
I see kids that are pretty spoiled. Uh-huh. Kids never worked a day in their life and never want to.
Well,
and
I'm gonna sit down there and buy a wheel.
It's sad.
Okay.
Well, it's about out of time, so I guess.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to add?
Anything else?
No, just that. I remember going to the field with my dad. He'd plow with the two horses, you know. We had a walking plow. And I'd have to walk behind him in the furrow and tell him if he's missing some ground, you know, we'd have to go up and down, make furrows. I remember going to the field and doing that, plowing up after the harvest. In the winter time. What they did when they had corn, very little corn grew, very little. The ears, they were not ears, they were just nubbins with just a few kernels of corn on. And they cut the whole stalk down in the fall and they make piles of it here and there, you know, with the stalks of corn. He'd go out and I'd go with him and we'd have to go through those stalks of corn and pick what few nubbins we could find. And the rest of the stalks he'd feed to the cows. But we did pretty good once we started the dairy, selling milk and cream. Had to carry we had to carry the quarts of milk to town and sell to the different houses that wanted them. And I was amused when my dad died, and then when mom died, a neighbor boy that liked to run around with Matt, he told us about, he said that he and Matt did the farming and work around there. And he'd come out and he'd help Matt once in a while so they could go do something together. And he said, you know, that one, he said, he was surprised about that one morning when he said he was with Matt and Greg come out and says, well, let's get this milk delivered now. We had enough milk and cream to deliver. They had to go by truck or car. So Matt says, okay, let's go. So the three of them got in the pickup and went to town with the milk, you know. And Matt and Al Eichmann, they had talked together before and said, let's get your dad mixed up, he says. They knew the route, but Pop knew he could figure out where he was and the route where who got milk first and last and how much, and he says, let's get him mixed up. And so Matt said, okay. So they went to town and delivered a couple quarts of milk this was at their houses, you know. And Matt says, well, Pop, we just delivered all this milk over here, now where do we go? Pop says, well, he says, if you'd stay out of the alleys and turn where you're supposed to, we'd be at Parker's now. He said he was so surprised. They couldn't get Pop mixed up, even though he is blind.
See?
But after we started the milk route and selling milk to stores and cream stores, we could buy some once in a while. We thought we were doing pretty good. Mm-hmm. You ought to pull the curtain.
Were you the first one to get a store-bought dress?
Oh, no. I don't know. No, I'm sure Jean and Mary Ann did. I was a freshman in high school when Mom went to town and saw that there was, she could see a dress for a quarter and another one, 75 cents. And she was, she'd get pretty nervous while she was sewing. She usually made our clothes, you know. And she, I heard her talking to Pop one, and she come home, she says, but Greg, she says, I didn't buy him, but I think I should have. She says, that, I get so nervous when I sew, she says, it just, I, if I had the money, I would, but I didn't think I had the money to, for those two dresses for me to go to school in. Papa says, well, go get those dresses. So she did, and I was so proud. I had two new dresses to wear to school for that year.
You went to private school, Catholic school, or was it public?
No, this was in high school.
In public?
You were in high school before you could wear store-bought clothes?
Mm-hmm. Well, for Christmas, all we got for presents was either if our stockings had holes in, we'd get a new pair of stockings or a pair of gloves if in the winter, you know, it's at Christmas time. We'd go to midnight mass and I'd hear these kids talking. But all they got for Christmas, and my friends got so many nice things, and I thought, gee, all I got was something I had to have.
So, yeah, it's amazing for me to hear you talk about how little you got, you know, a pair of socks or a pair of gloves for Christmas. And now my own mother, she keeps asking me what I want for Christmas. I'm like, I'm okay, I don't need anything. I'm, oh, all right, you have to give me a thing. And she's like, but I want to give you something. She can't help herself.
Yeah, I know you. But Mom would make a popcorn cake. Did I ever make popcorn cakes?
Like in an angel food cake pan?
Yeah.
Yes. One. I remember one time you making one of those.
And putting red hots around to decorate it.
Mm-hmm.
That was always a treat. And we always had a date nut cake. And I made one. Would you like to have a slice of date nut cake?
I'd like to try that. Sure.
Because it's supposed to age about 10 days or more. And if it gets too hard, you put a piece of bread and with it and put it in a, wrap it tight in an airtight bag or something and leave it for a day or so and it gets soft again. Ralph, no, who is it? Oh, Sean said he just loves those cakes and I didn't know it. So I did make one and I got half of it left. So I'll give you a slice if you want it. That was our Christmas. If we could get date night cake, that was our fruit cake. We didn't like the raisins or currants they put in the fruit cakes. And then popcorn cake and popcorn balls. Of course, St. Nicholas always came too at December the 6th every year. And that was nothing but a plate of fudge he'd leave at the door. It usually wasn't cooked long enough because they tried to cook it while we, without us kids knowing it. So that was Christmas, St. Nicholas Day and Christmas Day. Now my aunt and Aunt Vern would bring us maybe some oranges or apples or a bag of nuts or something. He was a dentist, and they'd come up to see Grandpa Farrell. And Oh, I thought that would be wonderful to have, be able to buy an apple or orange and a bag of nuts. So we didn't waste anything. We really didn't. For breakfast, in the summertime, Mom would take wheat and wash it real good after they harvested. And then she put it out in the sun to dry. And then we'd get the grinder out and grind it up, the wheat. And then she'd put it in the oven, or she made a paste like the wheat into a paste. And and then we eat it for breakfast, like grape nuts. That's hard to chew. Never do that unless it's straight out.
Okay. Oh, the curtains?
Yeah, because...
She's probably the curtains are bothering you.
Oh. Okay.
We couldn't buy cereal or, you know, cornflakes or anything. It cost too much.
Was it interesting when you graduated high school, got out on your own and had your own money to spend? Or how were things after you got out on your own?
Well, I had to watch my pennies, but I really enjoyed it. When I was a senior in high school, though, that's when Social Security came into effect. And I begged the folks to let me work downtown. And I went into Duckwalls and asked for a job. They paid me 10 cents an hour. And I worked 2 to 3 hours for about a week in the afternoon. Man, I thought that was really wonderful. But I had to get Social Security number then.
You didn't have one when you were born?
No, they didn't have such a thing. It didn't come to effect until later years. I heard about it.
Oh, yeah. But they didn't get, like, issue everyone when they started Social Security, just whoever got a job?
You had to have it to get a job then. That made a law that you could. You had to have a number to get a job. So then I ended up going to Wichita, and I worked a year down there at Cessna. And Marianne worked a year, or Marianne went down and got a job first. And then I graduated from high school and I went down. She worked at Boeing, and then Jean's husband, Victor, went to service, or he was called back. He was in service. He was called back to service, and Jimmy was just a baby. Jean went home with Jimmy and talked Mom into taking care of Jimmy while she came to Wichita and worked too. Well, Marianne had a room there at Dr. Edgerton's. One bed, one room, and had to eat out all the time. And so when I went down, I was there a few days before I got a job at Cessna. Marianne worked first shift, which was daytime, and I worked nighttime all night, you know, from 11 to 8, I think it was.
What'd you do at Cessna?
Drill press operator. And then Jean came down, and she worked second shift. So Marianne would get out of bed, I'd go to bed. No, How was it? Yeah, I'd go to bed, sleep during the day. Then I'd have to get up and go out and grab a sandwich or something. And then Jean would come home and go to bed. So the bed was in use day and night. And we lived in Dr. Edgerton's house with them for several months. And then we found a place where we could, you know, have a, fix our own meals and stuff. Jean was a nurse at Beach. Mary Ann was, I don't know what she did at Boeing. And I was a drill press operator at Cessna.
What plane were the parts for that you were making?
Mostly wings. We had to learn how to sharpen the bits and everything. Then Victor came in port, and Jean wanted to take Jimmy to Philadelphia to see his dad. And so I was going to quit anyway to go into nurses training. So I went with Jean back to Philadelphia so I could take care of Jimmy when she and Victor went out. They went out, and I had to stay in the hotel and take care of him. Then I came home and I went into to Leavenworth. I had to go there for a little over a semester and a half before I went to the hospital in Topeka.
What did you enjoy about being a nurse?
I always wanted to be a nurse. We had a couple there in Omega that I just idolized them. I thought they were so nice. And I thought, that's what I'm going to do when I get big. Then I decided, well, I want to be a nurse because I want to buy my own clothes. Because they always look so nice. And I thought, Mom gets so nervous and chases us out of the house whenever she gets her sewing machine out. So I thought, I never wanted to be to sew and be so nervous like that. So as long as I could remember, I wanted to be a nurse. And now I've got granddaughters that are nurses. Jennifer wrote her thesis about being a nurse and why she wanted to be a nurse. She's going to give it to me the other night because she said it's about me. And she couldn't find it, but she said she's going to find it and send it to me. Then Katie up here, she wrote, I don't know how many pages about my nursing career. And I have it in there someplace, but I forget where it is now. And she became a nurse. Gee, that's pretty neat, you know? Mm-hmm. Marcy's a nurse now.
Family tradition.
I thought maybe one of my daughters would be a nurse.
I knew what it took, and I couldn't do it.
Couldn't do it.
No, when I had to clean up Greg's puke on the floor and a little girl, I said, I'm not going to be a nurse. I don't want to clean up that kind of stuff. You told me if it was
when he was a baby?
He was like 3 and I was 4 or 5. He threw up, slipped and fell in it. And I said, Mom told me if I was going to be a nurse, I had to learn to clean up that kind of stuff. I said, forget it then. I knew then I could not be a nurse. But I did enjoy working at the nursing home those 3 years in high school. I loved that job. taking care of the older people was fun. I didn't like cleaning up though.
You have to take some of the bad with the good.
So I chose a different career. I'm not so dirty to drop. I'm just a mom.
Louise always said she's going to be a hairdresser, beautician. But she never was. Except at home.
She didn't mind.
Did she?
Right in high school, she did.